Okay, so thank you all for coming out on this snowy day. I must admit that I'm very surprised that we have people here, but we're glad that you came. And we are lucky enough today to have Mr. Rob Bunch with the High Road Agency, and he's going to talk to us about social media. Rob?
Thank you so much. So I'm Rob Bunch. I'm the managing director at the High Road Agency. We are a marketing agency out of Johnson City is where our corporate offices are. We also have an office in Kingsport, and we do work with another agency out of Bristol, Virginia. We also have an office on State Street as well that we share with that agency. We are a full service agency. We focus mostly on digital, however, so web design, social media strategies and marketing, advertising in the space and those kind of things. Majority of my team come from a traditional media background, however, so we are well averse with broadcast and print and those kind of things as well. So we help clients with that too. Today we're really going to talk a little bit about social media. It's always hard in these settings to talk about social media because you never know where people's knowledge base is. And so hopefully by the end you all will have at least one takeaway that you can go back and implement in your business as well. This session is for you, and so really it's about what you all want to see out of it, so please make it very interactive. As you have a question, feel free to interrupt as we go along, and we'll answer those as we go along. We'll also have time at the end. I've planned about 45 to 50 minutes today, so we'll get you back to the office maybe a little bit sooner than you thought to, okay? It'd be helpful for me, though, if we could go around the room quickly for you to tell me who you are, maybe which business you're from, or what you do. And to make it fun, maybe talk a little bit about, since we're in Abingdon, maybe one, and it's snowy today, maybe one of your most favorite snow memories of the past. So we'll start here.
My name is Josie Russell, and I'm the Community Relations Manager at Second Harvest Food Bank.
Awesome. Great.
Gosh, snow memories. I guess just actually getting to stay home for snow instead of having to go to work instead.
There you go.
First time here. My name is Bob Thomas, and I am doing sustainable small dwellings.
Okay.
1,000 square feet now. Snow memory. Killington ski area.
Awesome. Just ski or snowboard or combination of both?
Both.
Both? Awesome.
I'm Kathy Lowe. I'm the director here at Virginia High Small Business Incubator. And I don't know if it was my favorite snow memory, but I went through a fence on the refrigerator door sleigh riding and got 11 stitches.
Something you remember, though, right?
It's a memory.
Yeah.
That's the best one.
I'm
here
today with marketing person here at the incubator, and my snow memory is just staying out all day in the snow, and I really do not remember it being this cold when I was younger.
Right, yeah. Maybe our blood gets thinner as adults.
Yeah.
My name's Angie
Prater.
I'm a people corporate a business lender slash advisor.
Cool. She's also going to do the presentation today, so we're going to tag team with just a little bit. An inside joke there.
We had a hill behind our house, and we had the church over, and we were sleigh riding in that hill. And the few people would go into the creek and say, "Man, how far are you going?"
I'm Kyle Craig. I have Computer Solutions, a computer repair shop here in Abingdon. And I also represent the VFW Post here in Abingdon and their social media tribe. Probably my favorite snow memory is when I lived in Italy and they got an unexpected 4 feet of snow one night.
Wow.
When we were all in the theater for the kids were having some event from school, we all walked out and there was the snow and they all lost their mind.
Sure. We don't know what to do with an inch or less, let alone 4 feet. So yeah. We are introducing ourselves. Tell us where you work and then maybe one of your favorite snow memories.
Val Ray, work for KVET, Food City, and Rapid Design. I've got a couple of snow memories. One of my favorite probably was when I was young, my aunts and uncles. My grandma lived literally at the end of my house on the rock. And we lived on the side of the mountain and went down beside grandma. So they had an old white Volkswagen vehicle and they would take the hood off of it to drag that to the top of the mountain. And then we'd all like lay down face forward and like form a pyramid, and I'd usually be on top because I was the smallest one. And then we'd go down the side of the mountain on the Volkswagen Buggy too. We all like hit something and just flew everywhere.
Very cool.
We worked in Michigan one year. Well, actually, my dad was working on it. And it snowed and it was over top of the car. We couldn't see the car, so we had to dig down. We just literally walked across the snow. We were already at the roof of the barn. We just walked up the top of the slide down.
Cool. Very cool. We are, for those of you that just came in, we are introducing ourselves, telling us what company you're with or what organization you're representing, and then maybe a favorite snow memory. So we'll go here and then right back to the gentleman in the jacket.
Sorry,
that's okay.
I'm with Mill and I'm with the Eastern Virginia Housing Authority.
Awesome.
And snow memory. I'm from Eastern North Carolina. I didn't grow up with a whole lot of snow. Getting stuck on the way to the airport and not knowing if I was going to make it.
Yeah. So, yeah. It can be anxious times for sure.
Yeah.
Sir?
Oh, I'm Mike Hubbard. And I'm from Arlington, Virginia originally. And we used to get some pretty good snows, not often. But when they came, they typically came up the coast. And, oh gosh, I remember the last one because what happened was it snowed about 12 inches and it rained on top of it. So it was like cutting down an iceberg. But that was part of the reason for getting out of Dodge and leaving and coming down here.
Yeah, I understand. I'll tell you my snow story and then we'll talk a little bit why stories are so important. So a couple of years ago, I have two sons. I have an 8-year-old and a 5-year-old. A couple of years ago, it was a snow day and I was actually working from home that day. And my wife went out to play with the boys. And my oldest child comes running in and says, "Dad, Dad, Truman's bleeding everywhere and you need to come out and help as soon as possible." And so I grab towels and the first aid kit and run outside. And my youngest has this huge gash in his forehead, and there's blood just gushing out of his forehead and down his face. And he's screaming because his mom is carrying him and trying to get him into the house. Not because he's bleeding from his head, but because he didn't want to go inside. And so he wanted to continue to play outside. So we get him in the house and we took care of his head and bandaged it up and those kind of things. But he was still mad because he couldn't play. They had been out and they had been shoveling. And so we had a small shovel that the boys were using. And my wife April picked it up and accidentally slipped out of her hand and hit our child in his forehead and gashed it open there. But so she felt bad, but he was really mad because he had to come inside and not play in the snow anymore. So the blood didn't affect him, it affected us more than him. Stories are really important. Social media is the vehicle that tells your story to people. And so really, when you guys think about things, think about what your story is. How are you telling that story? How are you using social platforms to share with people who you are? When we talk about social media, we're not just talking about your business's social media. We want to also talk about your personal brands as well. So think about it from both standpoints. I come from a traditional broadcast background, and part of my job before coming to High Road was to work with news anchors to help them develop their brand socially. So not only was I helping the television stations build their brand, but I was also helping the anchors. So as an example, you all are familiar with Josh and Sarah at WJHL. Josh does a really great job of showing people his brand by showing glimpses of what's happening in his personal life, as well as being candid and jumping on a webcam in the evenings from his desk as he's preparing news and those kind of things, and giving you a glimpse into the behind the scenes at the news station. So when you think about social media, don't just think about your business brand, but how are you also building your own brand, because your brand is just as important sometimes as your business's brand, and your personal brand a lot of times will be reflected on your business brand as well. So keep that in mind. Before we jump into the presentation, just want to share with you some best practices with social media. So this is the nuggets, hopefully, that you'll take away, if not anything else. Most small businesses know that they need to be on social media, but they don't do it right. And what I mean by that is, when we talk about social media, to us at High Road and for a lot of agencies, it's part of your digital presence. It's a must. You have to be on social media. At the end of the day, a lot of times it's not going to make your phone ring. It's not going to give you the return on investment that you all feel like you need to have. But it's the part of that foundation that as people are engaging with you and as people are looking for you, they're looking at your social media channels. So you have to be there. So even though it may not make your phone ring, and even though it may not make a donation come in, you have to be able to tell your story because people are interacting with your brand. So when we look at social media, the first thing that we recommend as an agency is for you to think about what platforms, right? So if we think about social media, there's probably, we could spend the next 10 minutes and talk about all the different platforms on social media. And we're gonna spend some time today looking at some of the more popular ones. But really, as a business, it can be very daunting to think about keeping up with 8, 10, 12 different social media platforms, right? So really you need to think about which platform makes sense for your business and which platform the people that you're trying to target are engaging with most, right? So you can't be everything to everybody. And so really thinking about, from a strategic standpoint, is it important for me to be on Facebook and Twitter, or Facebook and Instagram, or Pinterest or LinkedIn? So really kind of choosing the right platform for you. How we do that, and we're going to talk a little bit more about this in just a little bit, is we really kind of hone in on which platforms those audiences that you're trying to target are using. So if we're trying to target a millennial, as an example, we need to think about which platforms they're using, Snapchat, Instagram. If we're trying to reach women 35 plus, maybe it's Facebook. If we're trying to reach business professionals, we're going to be talking about LinkedIn. So really kind of thinking about which one works for you. Also, it's important for you not to just look at it from a national standpoint. If you're doing business in Southwest Virginia, you need to think about the trends of Southwest Virginia. So as an example, Twitter, our area of the country are late adapters to Twitter. So people are using it here, but they're not using it as much as people in other areas of the country are using it. And so those are things to be thinking about too. So that's one of the things that we would tell you first is which platform. The next thing that we would talk about is, and we probably talk about these about the same time, is who are we trying to reach, right? So the High Road Agency works with the Birthplace of Country Music, and we help them with their social for Bristol Rhythm and Roots. And I like to use them as an example because there's multiple different target audiences that come to Bristol Rhythm and Roots. They like to reach millennials. They like to reach moms. They like to reach music lovers that typically are between the ages of 35 and 55. And they like to reach baby boomers as well. So they have four different target audiences that we're talking to socially, right? So it's important to know primary target and then those secondary targets. And then it's important to know how those people are using the social media channels and how to communicate with them. So if we're talking to a baby boomer socially, as an example, we want to invoke emotion. We want to have them think about potentially their history and where they've been and where they're going, and really be able to show this is Bristol Rhythm and Roots when it started and you were here, and this is Bristol Rhythm and Roots today, and this is what it looks like, and really kind of make that connection for them. If we're reaching moms, as an example, mom festival goers want to know about safety, and they want to know where the bathrooms are, and they want to know all of those things about how to keep their family fun and safe during the activities of that festival. And so we may talk to them a little bit different than we talk to baby boomers, right? And then if we want to talk to millennials, millennials want information and they want it very quickly. And so they want basically a billboard in social media. So billboard best practices are 6 to 7 words typically. Same thing applies. So if you're writing paragraphs of information, after the first 4 or 5 words, you've lost your millennial. So really kind of creating a strategy to talk to each of those folks. It's really important, though, that as you're developing your content and as you're kind of walking through that content, that you make sure that you're writing content that's going to reach all of those folks, right? And that you're doing it a proper proportion. So what I mean by that is, if you know that baby boomers are your primary target, and you know that you need to be talking to them more than millennials, you may post every 2 or 3 times to a baby boomer and only once to a millennial in the same space. So really kind of strategically thinking about who the audience is and how I'm using that message to reach that audience. Okay. The next thing after we talk about the target audience is we're gonna talk about frequency. How often do I need to be reaching folks? And so frequency is important in the social space. Most of the time, what we find with business owners is that they are going to, they're gonna have social pages and they're gonna post when they think about it. So they don't have any type of strategy about posting or any content calendar. So they'll think, okay, I have a sale coming up in a couple of weeks, or I have a promotion, or I have a fundraiser coming up and I need to post about that. And it may be 2 or 3 or 4 work days before they're posting something else because they have 4 or 5 other hats that they're wearing, right? So show of hands in this room, how many of you only handle social media on a daily basis for your organization? Okay. Most people, as you can see, handle much more than that. They wear multiple hats. So social media is sometimes forgotten, right? Or put on the back burner. It's not important on the priority list as everything else. And so our recommendation is to figure out how often you need to be posting. Typically, if we're talking Facebook as an example, we would tell you that 3 to 4 times a week is probably good for a business. If we're talking about Twitter or Instagram, daily would be fantastic if you can. If we're talking about LinkedIn, a couple of times a week, relevant information to your industry or to you as a professional would be fantastic. If we're talking about Pinterest, it's really about building boards and engaging, and so that's kind of an ongoing thing. It's not necessarily, a set number for the week. But with all of that being said, really kind of hone in on how often you need to be communicating. The next thing is that we don't communicate the same way on each of the platforms, right? And so a lot of times what people will do is they'll push out the same message across every single platform. They're different users, how people consume the information on those social platforms is different. And so we would recommend that you strategically schedule things for Facebook separate than what you do for Instagram, separate from what you do from Twitter, right? And so just think about that as you're building that content. So for us, it's all about building the strategy, okay? So we've talked a little bit about that strategy already with as far as what platforms we need to be on, the target audience that we're trying to reach, how often we need to be posting. For us, we feel like you should be building your content out a month at a time, okay? So in order to be effective, we really feel like you need to strategically think about what's going to happen in my business, in my industry, over the course of the next month. What kind of promotions do I have coming up? What kind of community outreach things am I doing? What kind of special events am I participating in? And build that content all at one time. Really, you can probably, once you get the hang of it, can probably spend 2 to 4 hours and build out your social content for the month. With that being said, we would encourage you to use a scheduling tool to schedule your post. So there are programs out there like Hootsuite and HubSpot. Our team uses Sprout Social, which is a great tool that provides insights and those kind of things. Hi ladies, how are you? But it's great because you're able to go in and you can schedule your content. Now that doesn't mean that you're going to schedule it and forget it. That means that you're going to schedule it. If something changes and there's a snow day and that changes the relevance of your content, you're going to go in and change that. Or, you know, if some special event comes up and you're doing an additional fundraiser for something, you're going to go in and you're going to add that information. So really this content that you schedule out on a monthly basis is really meant to be kind of a big 30,000 foot view of your business. You are then going to go in throughout the month and add personality to it as well. So, you know, it's going to be hard, if we talk about Instagram as an example, it's going to be hard to schedule 30 days of content on Instagram. There are scheduling tools out there, like Rum as an example, that allow you to schedule, but really, Instagram is meant to take a picture, upload it immediately, and post it immediately. It's supposed to be instant, therefore the name. So really, it's going to require you to touch your campaigns. It's also important for you to go in and check your accounts on a daily basis for engagement. You know, how are people reacting to your post? How are people commenting and sharing and those kind of things? And really kind of looking at that. In addition, after you get through your month of planned out content, it's important for you to look at where we've been the last month. So a lot of those scheduling tools that we talked about, Sprout and Hootsuite and HubSpot, will have tools that will provide you reports on engagement and will show you which of your content is best and what's producing the best engagement and the best results. And it will allow you to take that information and then kind of customize your content moving forward for the audience that's engaging with you. The other things that we would tell you is that a lot of times when we sit down with a client and we'll talk to them about who they are and who they think their target audience is, a lot of times social media will tell them that their target audience is somebody else, right? And so we'll go in and we'll sit down with somebody and they'll say, okay, my target audience is women 25 to 54. And what we may find is that, well, you may say that, but socially, on Facebook, as an example, women 45 plus are the ones that are engaging with you. And so how we talk to a woman that's 45 plus may be different than how we communicate with a woman that's 25. So those are all things that are really important. So those are kind of must-haves for us when we talk about strategy. Again, which platforms we need to be on, who our target audience is, how often we are posting, and then, you know, are we building out a content calendar or are we being reactive with our social media? Are we thinking as we drive away, hey, I haven't posted on Facebook for the last 2 weeks. Oops, I guess I should probably put a post out there. It's really about having a strategy just like any other part of your business, right? You know, we don't do marketing blind. I'm sure you don't market. You have a plan to market the incubator here. You would do social media the same way. You would have a plan to do that. And a lot of times you'd be surprised how many businesses that we meet with, that's just not a priority or they don't have time. And really, honestly, it's easier for you to take the time up front to do it. So we'll jump into the presentation now. Again, it's hard gauging where people are in the room, and so we've kind of kept this kind of low level, but we're going to kind of walk through each of the major platforms and kind of talk about why it's important that you may consider being on that platform socially. So we start with Facebook. How many of you in the room have a Facebook account? For everybody, I think. Facebook has more than 2 million daily active users. 88% of those are 18 to 29-year-olds. 88% of 18 to 29-year-olds use Facebook. 84% of 30 to 49-year-olds use Facebook. 72% of 50 to 64-year-olds. And 62% of those that are 65-plus use Facebook. So I'm sure if we were to talk about who your primary target is in this room, most all of you have your target audience is in one of these categories. And with 62% being the smallest, Facebook is somewhere where you all probably should be. This is a fun fact, and it's just kind of a random thought, but I'll share it with you. I read it a couple of weeks ago. Smartphones, 80% of users socially are accessing that on their smartphones. So that's one stat. I'm sure that doesn't probably surprise people in this room. But a more interesting fact even to that is that there are more people that own smartphones than toothbrushes. So 3.7 billion people, 3.7 billion people in the world own smartphones. Only 3.5 billion people own toothbrushes. So I think when you add in third world countries and those kind of things, that kind of makes that, but it's still sad that more people have chose smartphones over toothbrushes. I guess that's good for dentists, right? Snapchat. Who uses Snapchat in the room? Okay. Snapchat has over 300 million active users. It reaches 41% of 18 to 34-year-olds in the U.S. every day. Over 400 million snaps are sent every day. Snapchat for business, for us at an agency, we would tell you that would be a low priority. Unless you're advertising in the space because you're trying to reach millennials, or unless you're doing some type of special event or festival that millennials are going to be attending. So we worked with Battle at Bristol for their social, and Snapchat was a big portion of that strategy for them. That makes sense because of the people that were attending that event, right? But on a daily basis, Snapchat is probably not something that we would recommend that you spend a great amount of time on. Twitter is next. Twitter has more than 317 million monthly active users. Who uses Twitter in the room? Okay. Sandy, what do you use Twitter for?
Well, I just tweeted about the workshop.
Yeah.
Other workshops that we involved in.
Sure.
Sometimes if I see an article that impacts small business, entrepreneurship, micro lending, I'll post it there.
Yeah. But you're like probably getting that information very quickly and reacting to
yes,
it very
yes.
quickly, so you're not spending a lot of time, right? And so people that are busy, business people or busy moms are the ones that are using Twitter, more men than women, but really it's about garnering your information very, very quickly, being able to scan very quickly, and so that's why there's a character count max, which I think they've just changed recently or getting ready to change. But it's really about getting information that's relevant to you quickly and then engaging with that and moving on, right? 36% of online Americans age 18 to 29-year-olds use Twitter, more than any other age group. Usage drops as ages increases, with 23% of those age 30 to 49 using the service, 21% of 50 to 64-year-olds, and just 10% of those age 65 and up, okay? So I would tell you that our region is a slow adapter to Twitter. I would also tell you, if I was a gambling person, that I believe that we will see less and less of Twitter within the next 5, 7, 10 years, because I just don't think that they are being as much as they want to be. And so either we'll see a buyout from another social media platform, or we'll see it dwindle away. That's just me personally. I don't have any hard facts, but just based on stuff that I have seen, that's what I would imagine. Instagram. Who's using Instagram? Lots and lots of pretty pictures on Instagram, right? Yeah. Instagram has more than 200 million monthly active users. Engagement rates on Instagrams are 15 times higher than Facebook and 20% higher than Twitter. On Instagram, again, it's about the image. It's about evoking emotion. It's about being able to tell your story through images. Most businesses do it wrong because they try to put up canned stock photos, things that aren't relevant to their industry. It's really supposed to be about you, and it's supposed to be in real time, or as real as it possibly can. So if we're selling, remind me the how you worded, I thought of small homes or container homes or those kind of things, but
small dwellings. Right?
Small dwellings.
And the dwellings being posted.
So
anything, yeah.
That's evoking a lifestyle, right?
Yeah.
Yep. And so Instagram is the place to do that because you're wanting to show people that they can live in a small dwelling and that they can live well in that and they can enjoy other areas of their life because their home is smaller and more contained, right? And so really, Instagram is great for that. So let me take another moment to do a PSA here. Social media is supposed to be real. How many of you go on social media and you think that your friends have the best lives ever because nothing ever goes wrong in their lives, right? Okay. If you're building your personal brand, we've talked about building your business brand, but we've also talked about the importance of building your personal brand. It's important for people to see what's really happening in your life. You know, obviously that's up to you and your comfort level, but I can tell you that people are relating more to people that are real in the space. That doesn't mean that you have to be the woe is me all the time person either. But it's about sharing who you are and what's happening in your life. So just kind of think about that. Think about that from a business standpoint, too. One of the things that's not in the presentation, but another nugget, 80-20 rule. And some of you that have been in some of my talks before have probably heard that before. 80% of the time, we want to be talking to our followers and to our consumers about things that they want to talk about. Only 20% of the time, we need to talk about our businesses and our products. 80-20 rule. Now, for really smart marketers, what they do is they 80% of the time talk about what that consumer wants, but ties it into their own messaging in a creative way. And then 20% will talk about their business in kind of a more aggressive way. But really, that 80% is about messaging them because they're really thinking about, hey, my audience wants to talk about this. So they want to talk about the ICE challenge as an example. And I know that's so 2009. But they want to talk about the ICE challenge. How can I make that relevant to Second Harvest Food Bank, right? So it's about raising money for funds or for good causes. And so we may talk about the ICE bucket challenge, but also then talk about the importance of raising funds and what that means to people. And so kind of tying those messages together. So being very thoughtful about how to message. Pinterest is next. All right. Men, show of hands. Who has a Pinterest account? Okay. So I think we actually have more than 7%, but only 7% of total pins on Pinterest happen by men. 30% of all U.S. social media users are Pinterest users. The median age is 40, However, majority of active pinners are below 40. Who uses Pinterest in the room? So our recommendation from a business standpoint is to use it to gather content that's relevant to your industry, right? So use it kind of as a Dropbox, so to speak, or a collection of things that you want to share, like-mindedness about what you're accomplishing, what you want to accomplish, a reflection of your goals, a reflection of who you are and what you're wanting to do. But a lot of times when we work with a company, we'll use Pinterest to kind of map out. If we see something really cool that's relevant to them and something that we want to share in content in the future, we'll pin it. And so it's there, and it's easy for us to collect that data and then push it back out later on. So really for us, it's about collecting that data that's like the business or what you're trying to accomplish. Make sense? LinkedIn. LinkedIn is the most effective social media platform for B2B marketing. It's not just the fact that 94% of B2B marketers are LinkedIn, that's significant. 66% rate is its most effective social media platform for B2B marketing. I think Cindy Hagelman has come and done classes here before. She's a LinkedIn guru in the marketplace. If she ever comes back and you haven't taken one of her classes, I would encourage you to do so. She does a lot of training with our team and with our clients as well. She does a fantastic job. Some things, though, that's really important, make sure that your profile is completed. Go through and put as much information in there as you possibly can about yourself and your position. If you were to go to my LinkedIn profile, not only am I talking about my role at High Road and what I do, but I'm also talking about High Road, the business. So I include that too, so that people have that connection back to High Road. In addition to that, it's really important that you make sure that your website, your business websites are linked in there, and your social platforms are linked in there, and those kind of things. All of that information is helping from a search engine optimization standpoint. So the more information that you can put in there, the more information that Google has. So if people are looking for marketing firm in the Tri-Cities, as an example, an entry point into that is through my LinkedIn profile. Same thing's relevant for what you do. It's a great place to push content about your business and your thoughts. Everyone on the High Road team blogs. It's just part of our job duties, and so we push our blogs out there, and then again, that's another way to entry point into High Road. But it also sets you apart as an expert in the field, too. And so, content is important on LinkedIn. It's important to the industry as well. So those are the platforms that we're going to talk about formally. Does anybody have any questions about platforms that we haven't talked about today? Okay. I'm going to leave this slide up for just a minute. You know, again, target audience is important. We talked about that. Our recommendation is it's better for you to do a couple of social media platforms well than try to do all of them. And so really think about which one or which ones make sense for you. And maybe that's more than a couple. But really have a strategy. So, you know, if your primary demographic is people ages 45 to 54, that's purple. You know, Snapchat at 10% is probably not where you're wanting to be. You're going to probably want to be on Facebook, Google Plus maybe, LinkedIn, Twitter. So really think about what that primary target is and really kind of hone in on that. Questions. Any surprises here?
I'm actually surprised Google Plus is still on there.
Yeah. Our recommendation from a business, you know, we've been told as an agency probably 3.5 years now, maybe 4 years, that Google Plus is going away. As you notice, I didn't include it in the presentation today. If you have a Google Plus page, it's important to continue to push content out to it. So if you're using one of those scheduling tools, push the content that you put on Facebook out to it. Push the content that you put to Twitter out to it, just because it's not going to hurt anything. Because again, Google's all about content and content rich. I wouldn't spend a lot of time, though, posting directly just on Google+. One of the other ones we didn't talk about, which is kind of a hidden gem, is YouTube. YouTube can be a challenge, though, because of video production quality and those kind of things. At the end of the day, this would be my recommendation to you. You need to decide as a business what your standards for video are going to be. So what I mean by that is if we are working with the birthplace of country music, and I told you that we work with the Bristol Rhythm and Roots Festival and some other things, they have a policy that there are no videos that are done from an iPhone or a tablet. Everything has to be professionally produced. That's their brand standard, right? I don't necessarily agree with that brand standard, but that's their brand standard. I would imagine KVAT would be the same way, is that their brand standard would be that. However, a lot of small businesses can do a lot with iPhones or with their phones and their tablets and create very, very rich content that people are looking for. In my opinion, what is online doesn't have to be highly produced. So you can take something as you're delivering one of those container homes or as you're building it, take a quick walkthrough and show people an update and upload them to YouTube. Google owns YouTube, for those of you that don't know that. And so what you put on YouTube also gives you credit from a search engine optimization standpoint. So when you upload that video, though, it's important for you to make sure that it transcribes and that keywords that people may be searching for in your industry are part of that transcript. So just don't jump up on your video and talk just to talk. Really kind of think about a strategy for that as well, so that that content will help you in Google and with your search engine optimization. Okay. One other slide here about some stats. So we talked a little bit about Snapchat. So Snapchat was crowned number one by American teens. Everybody, and the reason why I included this slide in the presentation is everybody wants to reach the millennial. So how do we reach the next generation? The next generation, really you have to be relevant for them in the social media platforms that they are on. And so I would encourage you, if you're trying to reach them, to think about that. However, I also would caution you, at the beginning of the presentation, I told you to be on platforms where your primary people are and secondary people potentially. Do not waste a lot of time being in this space if millennials aren't your bread and butter today. That doesn't mean that we don't need to have a strategy and be in the space, but don't spend all of your time and energy in a place reaching an audience that isn't your audience today. Okay. We're going to move on to advertising in this space, but before we do, are there any questions or thoughts about what we've gone over very, very quickly in the last 40 minutes or so? No? Who's heard the term pay to play? So I was even reading something last week, and you guys might have read this too. In December, Facebook changed their algorithm. And it actually was on the national news. I was at the gym last night, and it was on the national news at the gym. They have now made it even harder for businesses to reach people on their platform. Because what's happening is they're losing users because of so many different business posts, because of the effectiveness of the business posts. So prior to this change in December, on a good day, if you had 1,000 followers, you would reach about, on a good day, 10% with an organic post. So with a post that you send out there, you'd reach 10%. Now, of course, that number is going to grow as Kim shares it, and as Sandy shares it. That number potentially could grow because then their users who aren't connected to the page, or the people they interact with who aren't connected to the page may see that. But just organically, people that follow you, 10%. Statistics that's, or a stat that's being thrown around now is somewhere in that 3 to 5% range. Okay? So in order to reach people, you have to really pay for it. So the question then becomes, okay, if I have to pay for the audience, why do I need to have such a strong content strategy? And why did we spend 45 minutes of an hour presentation talking about content? When we reach those people and we engage with those people and they decide to make that connection with your brand, they want that content, right? And so it's important that when they begin that 360 back to you, that 180 back to you, that you have a strong foundation for them to look at. So they're not I'm not just advertising in the space, but there's stuff for them to look about. There's stuff about my brand, and there's information that will tell my story that if they go back and look through my page, that they will have that information. Pay-to-play is important. We're going to talk about Facebook and Instagram advertising today, mostly. We do all different types of advertising in this space, but we find that Facebook and Instagram are the most cost-effective in this market right now. Twitter is high dollar to reach, so we can reach many more people on Facebook and Instagram, almost 4 times or 5 times, a lot of times on Facebook and Instagram over Twitter. Snapchat is not, in our opinion, doesn't have a proven track record in the market yet in order to really sink dollars in there, unless you're doing some type of special filter for an event or those kind of things, and that could cost you anywhere between $10,000 and $15,000 for a special filter. LinkedIn is a challenge as well, unless you're recruiting. Recruiting needs to happen in the LinkedIn space. So from a recruiting standpoint, that's a great place to do it. But if we're just trying to reach eyeballs, unless you strictly have a B2B type business and that's your approach, it's hard because you're talking more in the line with the direct mail piece, an email direct mail piece, when you're talking about dollars for there. So we're going to talk a little bit about pay to play. I'm going to quickly go through the next couple of slides just because of time, but really think about what makes a good ad. Most of the time people will put stuff out there and it's way too much. They're trying to tell their whole life story in 150 characters or more. And a lot of times we just need that hook, right? We just need that billboard to grab somebody's attention. So a couple of best practices, visual guidelines. Guidelines require it. Your audience remembers it. And so there are some visual guidelines that Facebook has kind of become more lenient on. But even though they've become more lenient on it, we would recommend that you still stay within that. So there's a 20% rule, or there was a 20% rule with your photos. So as an example, your photos would come up, and then there's a 20% rule with text on that. So your fonts, anything that's fonted, or your logo would count as part of that. Again, Facebook has become a little bit more lenient outside of that 20% rule, but we still recommend that you don't put more font or, including your logo, that's more than 20%. A clean picture that tells your story, a cool visual, is going to make say a lot without using a bunch of words. Again, your audience is going to remember that. Relevant, make sure it's hitting your target audience. So the neat thing about advertising in this space is I can say I only want this ad to reach females between this age group, or I want to reach males, right? And so males interact differently with ads than females, and so think about who you're doing it, who you're advertising towards, and build your ad towards that person. So, you're not going to put out an ad that speaks to men to women and vice versa. So be relevant with the target audience. Use photos and use verbiage that will relate to those folks. And then there needs to be a call to action. Give them a reason to click. So just putting it out there with no call to action and no tie back for them to learn more or buy now or reserve now or those kind of things are going to get you in trouble. So here's a couple of examples. Really pretty visual, not very much text as you can tell, and then they've used every single place that they could put information, but it's not more than what people can see, so they're not having to click through to go further. This is a carousel ad on Facebook. I'm sure you guys have seen that, but it's where the creative continues from different pictures, And so it allows you to kind of tell your story in a unique way, and it encourages users to look through all of those pictures. Realtors do a really nice job of this most of the time. Credit card companies surprisingly do really kind of a cool thing with it. A lot of vacation type destinations will use carousel ads to do that too, because then you can kind of see different aspects of your vacation. Again, really pretty visual, not very much text. In my opinion, this one's even better because it has the shop now, that call to action at the bottom that we talked about. A couple more here. So they've incorporated the URL at the top and at the bottom. They're really focusing on that 30% off with some unique photos too, their product. So I would just encourage you to look at creative. And kind of just something that you saw in all of those is, again, real small text, not a lot of text there. Be very relevant about it. Yes, sir?
Can you explain the 20% rule again?
Sure. So let me go back to one of these, and I'll just use it as an example. So when you upload this photo, only 20% of this area should have some type of font in it. So this PayPal logo and all of this is considered part of that 20%. Now again, Facebook has made that more lenient and they'll allow you to do more, but really you should not have font or logos that make up more than 20%. There are tools out there that can do a grid system that will show you what that 20% looks like, so as you're designing it, that will help. Kind of some added value for you all today. Images, a lot of folks in my team like to use Canva. Canva is a free tool. I think they also have a business subscription now, but for personal users, you can download that. It allows you to, it has photos that you can use, as well as it allows you to put font text in, and add your logo in, and those kind of things. So a really kind of cool resource for you to use out there. For that. Folks, do not use pictures that don't belong to you on social media. If you're going to use stock photos, get a stock photo license. So go, you know, subscribe to Adobe or subscribe to one of those photo services that you're going to use. Use Facebook's free, use Canva's free photos, find a free source, but make sure that you have rights to use that. I can't tell you how many times businesses have gotten cease and desist from Facebook with a $3,000 or $5,000 bill attached to it because they didn't have rights for a photo. Don't do it. So when we're advertising in the space, and we're going to kind of go through this pretty quick because I'm going to actually get into Facebook and show you that too. When we're advertising in this space, the first thing that you're wanting to do is determine what you're wanting to accomplish. So I think there's probably 10, maybe 12 different ways to advertise in this space right now, so we'll show you that. But figure out what you want to do and what objective is going to get you to the goal. We're going to look at our audience. So who's the audience that we're trying to reach? Placement, so where do we want the ads to be placed? Facebook will give you a couple of options and we'll look at it too. You can place them within Facebook, you can place them Facebook and Instagram, and then Facebook also has what they call an audience extension program. And so that means that your ads will be on different websites that Facebook has relationships with. And so that will drive your cost down because they're sharing that with other people within their network. But again, you need to determine what's best for you and your business. You need to determine your budget. A lot of times people will throw $25 or $30 at a Facebook ad and think that that's enough money. you need to kind of know how many people you're wanting to reach and how much you need to reach them. So in the digital space, I'll tell you, ideally you want an 8 frequency. So you're going to want to reach your audience at least 8 times in the space. A minimum, we tell you, is 3 times. So newspaper, broadcast television, broadcast radio is 3 times. So if you can't afford to reach your target audience 8 times, either make your geographic radius smaller so you can, or at least go for 3, a minimum of 3 times. Then you're going to craft your message. Again, you saw best practices that we showed you, short, concise messages that get your story out. Think billboard-esque. Then you're going to optimize. So a great thing about Facebook is that you can go in every single day or more and see exactly how many people are interacting with your ads, and you can turn ads off. You can add additional ads. You can shift your target based on how many people are engaging with your ad. So many times we'll set ads, or businesses will set ads, and then they don't look at it. So if High Road handles a campaign for you, as an example, we have someone going in at least once a day, sometimes twice a day, looking at all of the ads that we're running for clients to optimize those. So we'll do a lot of A/B testing. So we'll pick a couple of different target audiences and potentially see which audience is engaging with us most. We'll do the same thing with creative. So we'll run a couple of different creative messages and see which one is running best over the course of a couple of days, and turn one off and let the other one run. Facebook will also do some self-optimizing, but again, you're having a computer then optimize for you. You guys know your goals and objectives better than Facebook does. So questions before we walk through kind of the back end of Facebook. How many of you are currently advertising on Facebook or Instagram now? Okay, so a good number. We find that the easiest way to do that is through the Ad Manager. So when you come to your page, it's probably going to look something like this one, maybe.
Do all ads have the word sponsored at the top of them?
Most of them do, yes. Yeah.
Let's see, can we get it back?
So yeah, this is what the back end of Facebook looks like. I have it pulled up, Sandy. I don't know why it won't show up there. Do you know why it wouldn't show up there?
You can try maybe go into settings and displays.
Okay.
Sometimes there's a button to push it. So that happens to be one time.
I'm just surprised that it's shown the whole presentation on this.
Yeah, isn't that strange?
Brand your computer, but like F5, F6, F7, one of those usually project.
There.
There you go.
Awesome. Okay, so this is Facebook, as you can tell. Ad Managers is typically over here. A lot of people for businesses will use Page Managers or Business Manager too. We like the Ad Manager just as well. Guys. All right. So this is your dashboard. As you can see, we have lots of different ads that we run for clients. Go into Create Ad, which is in that top right-hand corner. And this is what you see when you come into this section. And we're going to walk through this really fast just to kind of keep us on time. If you guys go back to your businesses and want us to come in and just walk you through this, feel free to either give us a call or schedule an appointment with us, and we would be happy to do that with you. So there are numerous different ways, like I told you all, you could build brand awareness and reach. Until about a year ago, there were things like campaigns, where you can choose campaigns for people to like. They've changed that more to reaching people and brand awareness now. There's traffic, which means that it's going to push traffic to your website or to an app or those kind of things. Video views is another big one. You can also do conversions if you have some type of e-commerce catalog store, sales and store visits as well. Traffic is the one that I would tell you that we use most. This will drive traffic directly to your website. So this is different than boosting a post. So a lot of businesses will take a post and they'll boost that to a particular audience. That's great in some instances. If you're going to spend money on Facebook, though, we feel like you should also have another metric. And so we really recommend running ads in the space, not just boosting. So if you're going to boost, that's great. But if it was an either or situation, we would recommend that you run an ad before you boost a post. Okay. So for this case, we're going to just create a traffic campaign. You can put any name that you want in there. And it's going to ask you where you want to drive traffic to your website or to a mobile app or to Messenger, Facebook Messenger. Website is the one we're going to use for this one. And then we're able to begin to define our custom audience. You can also title your custom audience. So every time you come in, you can choose one of those audiences that you've already set up. But in this case, we're going to go ahead and set this up. Abingdon, Virginia is where we're going to choose, maybe, if it pulls it up. There we go. And you can actually choose a radius around a location. You also can add zip codes in here. You can add counties in here, so numerous different ways to. You also could put Bristol, Virginia in here as well as an example. So you can put multiple different radiuses in here. Always be careful when you do this, though, to really see where your audience is already. So there's no need, in my opinion, to add Bristol, because as you can see, when we click off Bristol, we've already encompassed that area in Abingdon. So that's just duplicated, right? But if I wanted to reach Johnson City, and if I were to draw a bigger radius around Johnson City, my circles still overlap. So what I could do is maybe make Abingdon a little bit smaller and Johnson City a little bit smaller so that I'm reaching unique audiences in both places. So just something to think about there, okay? So I am gonna reach, let's say, people 25 to 54. So you can change the age. We only want to reach women, per se, so you can choose that as well. And then you can start adding in your detail targeting here. So let's say that we wanted to reach home buyers. You can type in home buyers. In this case, we'll choose, there should be home buyers in here. Not sure why it's not pulling it up, but we'll just use homeowners for this particular example. Sometimes you have to search in there for the category that best represents you, so just kind of keep that in mind. You also can add multiples. The other thing that's really kind of cool too is you can narrow your audience or expand your audience. So we want to reach homeowners, but then you also can say you can exclude people from that. Let me give you an example. Last year, High Road ran a campaign for Sony, and they were pushing out a new movie that they were running, and it was about boxing and Christian boxing. It was a Christian religious story about boxing. And so they wanted to reach certain markets, but they only wanted to reach people that were Christians. And so we had to go in and we had to do boxing interest, and then we had to do excluding non-Christian. Mm-hmm. And so those are the types of situations where you would include.
Hey, Rob, is all that information on the demographics, is if people put it in their profiles that they're a homeowner?
So that's a great question, Sandy. So we are really social people, right? And so we tell Facebook a lot of different things. And so, you know, they're going to know based on our setup for the most part, who we are, age-wise, where we live. You know, they're going to ask us questions about which high school we went to, which college we went to, those kind of things. Based on the information that we are engaging with on social media is how they then are telling the story. So if I post a picture of my backyard, Facebook is smart enough to know that I'm a homeowner, or make the assumption that I'm a homeowner based on that information, if that makes sense. So that's the audience that we talked about. Remember we talked about the ad placements? So you, by clicking on placements, you can pick and choose where you want it to be. So Facebook will deliver your message in this case in all of these different places that are checked. So the right column is over here, your Insta articles, and you can look to see what each of those look like in your feed. So articles that are delivered to you, and you click on that article, and then that ad will be in that article. That's what an Insta article is on Facebook. Instagram, it's showing in feeds. Stories is coming, so they're working on that. Audience network, that's the people that have relationships with Facebook, and that Facebook is selling their inventory. And so a lot of times, if I want more of a less, if I want more of a true Facebook buy, we will not do an audience extension, because it's not then running on Facebook, it's running on somebody else's site. So that's important to keep in mind too. And then Messenger is your social messenger, your Facebook messenger. You can also choose if you only want to run your ad on an Android or on an iOS or iPhone system, you can choose that. A lot of times that would be relevant if you're pushing out a new app. So if you were promoting an Android-only app, you would want to choose to only push that out to Android users. The other thing here too, I don't know if you guys can see it, only when connected to Wi-Fi. So only deliver if somebody's connected to Wi-Fi. Again, maybe relevant. So when we look at budget, and we're not going to spend a lot of time here, but when we look at budget, this is going to help you. So with our target audience that we put in above, there's potentially 67,000 people in that target audience. If we were to spend $20 a day, we're going to reach between 1,500 and 6,100 of those folks. So you would need to do the math to see how often or how many days you need to run at that level to be able to get your minimum three frequency or eight, your ideal eight frequency, minimum three frequency to hit those 67,000 people. This also tells you how many clicks to your website that you should be garnering from the money that you're spending, okay? I prefer to do lifetime budgets. It's just easier. So I have seen it a lot of times where somebody puts in accidentally a number, an extra zero or an extra two zeros, and they get their credit card bill and they now have spent $2,000 on an ad that they thought they were spending $20 on an ad. I'm smiling over there, Kim, has that never happened to you, has it?
It really hasn't.
That's good.
It's a fear.
It has happened to me. And so I like to say when it's going to start and when it's going to end. Like any other creative and messaging out there, you don't want your Facebook ads to run the same for a really long period of time. So really think about how long it needs to be out there. Ideally, no more no more than a week or two at the most. At a minimum, change out your creative on a monthly basis, okay? Questions about any of that section before we move on? We're going to wrap up here in the next 5 minutes or so, so we're kind of moving fast through this information, I know.
You would just use the ad manager if you were paying, right?
Yes. Yep. Pay to play. So here's where you can choose the different types of creative messaging or the creative imaging that you want to use. You could do that carousel ad that we talked about, and it gives you an example of what that looks like. You can use a single ad, you can add a video or a slideshow or a collection of photos in there. And for this instance, I'm just going to do single image. As you can see, Facebook has a free stock library, so you could go in and use theirs by just searching for what you're looking for. They're already sized properly and those kind of things. Again, be guarded against stock photos, so make sure that that stock photo is relevant to you and looks like your region. So as an example, if you're selling cars or trucks, let's say you're selling trucks, you don't want to have a Ford 150 in front of the Rocky Mountains and put that on your Facebook page here as an example. I'm just going to upload a picture that I took yesterday. So as you can see what I did there, just so that you know, I went in, and because my picture didn't fit, because it's a little bit longer, I went ahead and adjusted what it would look like. So rather than it load up here, I want to see that barn and those mountains, and so I've cropped the photo. It will show more on Instagram because Instagram is square and Facebook is rectangular at this point. Okay. It will allow me to put in a URL address that I'm trying to push traffic to. I can enter text here as well, and then a headline. Text, even though Facebook has made this more lenient as well, I would tell you no more than 120 characters in your text at the top. Your headline should be somewhere between 25 and 40 characters at most. Always choose a call to action if you can. So there's 6 or 7 listed there. You also can add different languages too. So if you have, a Spanish class that you are trying to push information for, or a bilingual class, you could put that information there. This display link will actually be how your website is displayed. And then you also can provide some additional information that will show up in your news feed as well. And then when you're ready to go, you just hit confirm. And it will post. One other note down here, this pixel right here that you guys see that's turned on, what that does is that allows you to take that pixel and put it into Google Analytics, and then Google will track the traffic that's coming from Facebook and from this ad, and will give this ad credit based on that pixel that you put in there. You also can put that pixel on your website, and that will also provide opportunities for retargeting. So once people come through Facebook to your website, then you can also then purchase ads to retarget those folks as well. You hit confirm, it'll let you review your order and those kind of things, and they'll go live. I'm not going to post this at this time. But that's really kind of how you put together ads for Facebook. It's also the most easy way to advertise on Instagram at this time, too.
Probably if somebody viewing online would know if they could have if the slides would be available.
Sure. I'll give them to you before I leave, and then I can post them. Yep.
Thanks.
No worries. All right. So we're really just kind of at question and answer time. Any questions? Comments? Things that I can answer for you before we send you back to work for the day.
Somebody else wants to advertise on your page. Talk about that.
Sure.
How do you put value to that?
Yeah, so.
How much to charge for that?
Yeah, yeah. So we work with WCQR. I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with them, but they're a Christian radio station in the market, and we work with their parent company, which is Positive Alternative Radio, and so we work with all of their radio stations. They have six. But really what you do is it depends on how you're going to advertise for them. And so how they do it at WCQR is a couple of different ways. They look at their overall audience. So if they have 50,000 followers, you know, if I put out a post and it's going to reach, and I'm going to tag you and mention you in an organic post, and I know that I'm going to reach 10% of the 50,000 followers, what's the value of me tagging you in that post? So we can look at that. You know, they do a lot of, how they do it is they sell a lot of Facebook Lives, and so they will have a underwriter or a client that they work with that they'll go out and they'll do a Facebook Live and they have a value on that. And then if they're going to run a promotion on the back side of their Facebook page to promote an event like Secret Keeper Girls that's coming up in February, I think, at Celebration Church, they will charge accordingly to that. So it just depends on what they're trying to accomplish, what each of those values are. And really it's about you setting the value for what you think that's worth and what you think that somebody will pay you to do. That does bring up a good point though. So if you work with a bunch of manufacturers or vendors that you partner with, as an example in your industry, being able to tie in and provide relationships with those people are important. And so tagging them and being strategic about tagging them just to tag them for goodwill is a really good thing, and they'll do the same thing a lot of times. So that's how that works. But you know, there are no rules against allowing other people to advertise on your page. It's really about you setting the value and you determining what the costs are.
Somebody's willing to give us $2,000 worth of soil, for instance, in London.
Yes.
And we're wondering, and they in return they want to advertise on our page, how much to give them, how long to give them, how often to give them. We don't know where that is.
Sure. So you know, really the value of the view, and I haven't looked at it recently, but 6 months ago or so, one person engaging with your post was worth between $4 and $6 on Facebook. So, you know, if you have 1,000 followers and let's say 10% of those people are going to see it, you know, that may be a $60 value for that post. And so determining what that looks like for your vendors. The important part is, even if you're not charging them for that, if it's kind of an in-kind, being able to tell them what that value is or that return on their investment is a big thing. So, you know, I would recommend that you do a little bit of research of what the value of a view is on Facebook, and then kind of determine it that way. And I'll give you all my cards too before you leave. And if you have any other questions about that, we can kind of look at that for you too and give you some suggestions as well. Great question.
You mentioned Facebook Live.
Yeah.
So what are some, I mean, I've only done it a few times on our page, but
sure.
What are some suggestions or what do you have to add about Facebook Live and maybe using it on our business page?
Sure. So Facebook Live is it goes back to that standard of what's, you know, what's considered good video and what's not. And so a lot of companies won't do it because it's not up to video standards. I recommend that you do it. It's a glimpse into your business. It's a glimpse into who you are, right?
Yeah.
Don't do it just to do it. Do it to have purpose and a strategy. So really think about where it fits into your content strategy. Think about what's going to evoke emotion. Couple of other things that I would recommend if you use it is make sure that you always put a description in there, because that's important for after the live part. Also, really be strategic about when you do it. So look at your insights as far as when people are engaging with your brand. And so if you're doing it at 9 o'clock in the morning, but you know that most people engage with you between 3 and 5, do it in the afternoon. And so I'd really be kind of, I'd watch those two things specifically with Facebook Live.
We're streaming this on Facebook Live right now. He's got 157 views, and he's had 6 shares since this started.
Awesome.
That's awesome. And it's reached 438 people.
And our best investment is that little hike on that.
With me on the camera.
How much was that?
The little name of it.
It's less than 500, but it allows you to basically, I'm the producer, and I can just move wherever Rob moves. I can move it, the camera, or the, where it's looking at.
And I've kept her busy today because I've moved all of us.
Yes, I've got all those presets recording.
So thank you so much for participating. On this snowy day, we almost canceled this class, and my boss over here convinced me that I didn't need to, so she was right once again. The High Road Agency just came on with us with our new knowledges this year, and we've had some excellent classes from them, and so we thank you so much for helping us present these new knowledge classes. Next week, January the 31st, will be cash flow forecasting that will be held here in the incubator, and one of the CPAs, Ms. Phoebe Blevins, will be presenting that class. It will be a very informative class. And just as a reminder, we start our business plan challenge on January the 23rd here in this room at 6 o'clock. And even if you are not a competitor, you are welcome to attend these 6 business training classes to help you promote and learn to grow your business. We have a variety of presenters, everybody from the Small Business Administration to Virginia Community Capital.
We have a number of entrepreneurs too that are sharing some of their knowledge too. So with 6 weeks, and this will be our 5th year, and I have never seen anybody that has participated either one night or all 6 that didn't come away with something, either building a relationship with the business or firm that you wanted to. And we all, as a professional, we grow as we learn, and we grow some really good skills.
Right, we've had some great success with that, so we're looking forward to the beginning of the 5th Annual Small Business Challenge. Are there any other questions for Rob before we close today?
I don't have a question, but if you come in late, would you please fill out the sign-in sheet to remind me who we have?
And if
you will please fill out your evaluation, because that helps us in planning our next new knowledge classes.
Well, thank you so
much. Thank you for coming out on this snowy.
It was very informative. And you are going to hand out business cards, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
And if anyone wants a copy of the presentation, email either Jennifer here at the incubator or myself, Cindy Riley, sbratcliffe at bcc.va.org, and let me know. I'm meeting you.